It is 1:30, so I'd like to call the meeting to order. And this is the April 22nd, 2021 meeting of the Town Council's Financial Oversight Committee. With us is Chris Solnier, Brian Quimby, myself, Jim Broderick, Rich Ficaro, Steve Lonergan, and Mary McNally, and Bruce Finney. Thank you all for joining us. I will just say and ask if anybody is recording this meeting other than LCAT. Okay, I hear no yays to that. And finally, just to let you know that the meeting is being held via Zoom in accordance with the governor's orders of March 16th, 2020. So the first order of business is to review and approve the minutes of April 15th, 21. Rich, for having not taken minutes before, you did a darn good job.
By the way, I do have one question for you. My wife wants to know if it's a line item, the people who type the minutes.
If you can find one that we can't see, you're all set. Are there any questions or corrections? Oh, hi, Mike. We're just starting looking at the minutes.
Great. Hello, everyone.
Any questions, corrections, et cetera, on the minutes? So I just had one, Rich, and it was on page 3, where we had the discussion about whether we vote as we go along or vote at the end. Mm-hmm. And so the minutes appear to say, Jim, vote as we go along on individual budgets. I would refer maybe to language that Jim raised the question whether we want to vote on budgets mm-hmm. as we go along or vote on all budgets at the end. And that the consensus was to vote on all the budgets at the end at our May 12th meeting.
I guess it was to vote on all the budgets at the end.
Yes.
Okay, got it.
Is that correction okay with folks?
Fine with me.
Fine with me.
All right. Then can I hear a motion to approve the minutes with that one change?
So moved.
Okay. And
I'll second.
Okay. Other discussion? Hearing none. Let's vote. And so that's Chris.
Yes.
Rich?
Yes.
Jim? Yes. I wonder if we, I don't even want to raise the issue of a quorum, but we do have 3 out of 5, so.
I was going to ask that.
I would think that usually it's at least 50%, but.
Correct.
Out of quorum. But so we'll assume that we do, and if it's incorrect, we can deal with that however we have to. All right, thank you. Next order of business, this is our meeting to review and discuss the recommendations of the Town Manager's Capital Planning Committee. We're pleased to have Bruce with us and Ryan with us to answer any questions. It's funny, both of you, because we kind of ordered this our schedule so that we look at the capital planning recommendations and then we get a follow-up hit at you both when you come and discuss your overall budgets. We get a second chance to make sure we understood what was discussed. So thank you for joining us. Now, we all were presented with the budget summary of what was what was recommended. And I understand, as Mary updated us last meeting, I believe, the network upgrades were required sooner rather than later. So for FY22, at least, that $200,000 won't be part of the recommendations because it has already been purchased. So that'll reduce at least what exists for the recommendations down by $200,000 to $1,055,117. I don't know how you'd like to proceed. I have some specific questions from Kathy and Tom, but unless you would prefer to just kind of go through anything that people have a question on, I'm open either way. Chris, do you have specific questions or are you looking for overviews?
I have some questions. I was thinking maybe if we take them one at a time as we go through them, then the corresponding department head would be able to shed some light on what we don't seem to see.
All right. So if we look at the spreadsheet that starts with proposed FY22 capital projects, that's the two pager.
Mm-hmm.
We can use that as our means of going through the projects. Does that work for folks?
Yes.
Okay. So the first one is the IT one-to-one replacements, which is $132,005. This is a continuation of the plan that we've had to get every student a device, which worked out very well last year when we had no choice but to do the remote learning. Anything you want to add to that, Ryan?
The only thing I would point out is the 132.5 is a higher number than is standard because last year the number was reduced. So instead of taking the reduction from last year and putting it all into this year, I split that reduction over this year, or I'm sorry, off of FY22 and FY23. So FY22 and FY23 are 132.5, and then FY24 it'll drop back down to 125,000.
Okay.
The next item is the fire department, year five of five lease payment on the ladder truck.
That's a commitment.
So it's pretty much I would guess a no-brainer unless we want to severely rock our credit rating. So, next item is Eastline Meadow Public Schools Mountain View replace portable modular trailer classroom with permanent structure. And this is for $950,000. This was on the list last year at a higher level. Like $1,350,000, Bruce, was that it?
Yes. $1,352,086.
And I know that Kathy did make a note that she wanted to underscore the critical need to replace the Mountain View modulars from her standpoint.
Yeah, they're really bad.
The question that Tom had, and I see in my notes, I kind of asked it, but I don't think I ever specifically asked it, is I know that the amount went down because now you're going stick built, as I understand.
Right.
The question was at 2,000 square feet, which roughly comes out to $315 a square foot, seems still very rich for that type of construction project. So what is it that's driving that up?
Well, obviously we've took the number based on what we did at Meadowbrook School. So we took that number based on the square footage at Meadowbrook School and applied that to Mountain View because we just finished up that project last summer. So we took that dollar figure and obviously applied it to Mountain View and obviously built in a little contingency as well. So that's where we derived at those numbers.
So just a stupid question then, why was Meadowbrook so expensive? Is there something about the construction that's more...
Well, this, we kind of went through a study phase, I guess you could say, when it came to Meadowbrook School. So the conclusion when we started designing the project is typically when you go to modular construction, it's cheaper because it's pre-built in a different location, everything else. But given if you're going to add or modify those existing, I guess, modular construction boxes that you build, it actually costs more. So based on what the needs of the school are and everything else, we did a study and comparison in talking with the modular manufacturer, and it ended up being cheaper for us to get what we want, specifically for the school's needs, is to go with a conventional framed building.
So I think I'm still not, maybe I'm not asking, I'm not phrasing myself correctly. Okay. I'm just curious what drives the is $315 per square foot considered high?
It's that's kind of a loaded question. I think it's actually kind of low in today's standards, more specifically right here and now, based on what the construction industry is going through, more specifically materials. But like I said, we ended up reducing that based on, like I said, what we just currently did at Meadowbrook School. So that's how we came up with the specific price that you see before you.
All right. I guess, I mean, I was on the capital planning committee, so I voted for it, but I'm just kind of, it just kind of hits me that I guess I'm looking for either there's special requirements that have to be built into these structures or, you know, extra special kinds of things that are out of the ordinary for, you know, 2,000 square feet or.
Right. No, it's more, it's just commercial construction. So you have specific materials, there's different criteria than residential construction that you have to adhere to. Insulation, sound, fire sprinkler systems, the HVAC system has to meet certain standards more as far as efficiency, things of that nature. So there's kind of a lot of underlying factors that go into a stick-built facility like this.
All right, thank you, Bruce. Rich?
Yeah, I find the key very effective. So I just want to make sure I understand this. This project is coming from the general fund bonding. Is that the way I read the GFB? Yeah. For general fund.
Yes, that would be correct.
Thank you so much.
Chris?
Yes. Are we taking some from the general fund? And how much are we bonding for this project?
Jim, if I may, I think it's all going to be bonded, Chris. It's just a bond out of the general fund as opposed to a bond out of one of the enterprise funds.
Okay, so the actual cost in the budget for 22 is not the $950,000. It's just will be the debt and interest?
Well, it won't be probably for 22. It'll probably not be till 23 or 24 at the rate we go about things. But you're correct. We generally will reduce that project amount by the debt service that we pay year to year.
Okay.
Yeah. Chris raises a good question, Mary, and Ryan. I don't know if we discussed it while we were still meeting as the capital planning, but it would be helpful in terms of looking at the annual cost for the debt and interest as opposed to the principal amount, because. We're kind of going under the assumption, we need to see the principal amount to see the investment, you know, that the town is making. But in terms of the impact on the town's operating budget, the debt and interest would be a more useful number.
Yeah, and that was one of the things I brought up in the capital planning meetings too, was having a roadmap so we can see that and see what the impact is and see when it makes sense to shift capital projects around where it might fit better and carrying that long-term debt and interest.
Chris, did you have a question?
No.
Okay. Is it possible to to calculate the projected debt and interest expense, annual debt and interest expense for these projects that we're planning to bond?
Jim?
Yes.
We would have to call our Hilltop Security, who does our bonding, and whether it makes worthwhile or not. They can produce schedules. I'm not sure what kind of time frame. It's fairly quick, so I should be able to get something for next week.
Yeah, because I think last year we did use the bonding costs when we made our recommendations on the impact of on the town's operating budget and the impact on tax rate. So I think it would be helpful, Steve. I don't know how others feel.
And that's something I wanted to probably include in the comprehensive capital plan too, so we can see it on there and see what the impact would be. You know, when the fire department needs a new fire truck in 7 years, see where that does our with our debt and interest payments.
Yeah. So yeah, that would be very helpful if you don't mind, Steve.
The only the caveat to Ryan's point to remember is right now we're at historic lows for rates. And it's not anticipated that to the point of the fire truck 7 years out is going to be at 2.5-3%. It might be 4 or 5. And they'll make assumptions, and I'll let everybody know about that.
Well, I confused you on it. I'm only talking about the new projects that we're recommending for FY22.
Okay. All right.
Yep. You don't have to try to figure out, you know, this one's done, you know, and projecting the cost for an estimated new project, just the ones that are being recommended for approval this year for FY22.
Hey Jim, before you move on,
yes, Bruce.
Did you guys receive this as part of your capital submission? Kind of the breakdown for Mountain View School. I just want to make sure you understand. What we're asking for. So like you said, part of the project too is the demolition of the existing structure and everything underneath and everything that goes along with it. So you have demolition fees. We have obviously the $315 a square foot. The construction cost is roughly $650,000. Contingency is 15-20%, which is about $100,000 to $130,000. Escalation factor of 5% is roughly $32,000, and then consulting fees for somebody to design the project too as well is $110,000 to $130,000. So hopefully that makes a little more sense, or hopefully I didn't confuse you even further.
The answer is no, that wasn't part of what we received. So yes, it was helpful that you broke it down that way.
Okay.
Yeah, I think a lot of that information would be more capital committee for review.
And I guess it does help to explain how a 2,000 square foot project can get bulked up to a 950,000 total cost.
It does. There's a lot that goes on before you even start the project. So anyways.
And it reminds me of doing tax credit bonding deals. There's so many costs that go into it.
Yeah, and you don't realize them. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Any other questions on the modulars? Okay. So the next one is the cruiser replacement program. And this is, in essence, a continuation of the idea of replacing two cruisers every year. And then the next one is server upgrades. Yes, Rich.
Once again, just me getting used to that key. It says CCP. Does that mean we're using money from closed capital projects to fund this?
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
Thank you, Mary.
Good question, Rich. So that's the server upgrades for $23,000. Any questions for Ryan on that? Okay, then police for a new generator, $34,000, and the anticipation is that we should be able to get the funding via a grant. Yes, Chris.
How confident are we that we're going to get that money from a grant?
I'm very confident.
Very.
Who's writing the grant?
It was myself, and actually I got a little help from Tig and Bond to put this together, but this is for the generator at the town hall and the police station. Police station was actually in next year's capital plan in FY23, but we moved it up into this year's just because of, like you said, the grant.
It's a MEMA and FEMA sponsored funding source, Rich.
Thank you very much.
That police department generator is tired. I mean, every time we have a power outage, it fails or something goes wrong.
So will this actually be situated by the town hall?
The town hall unit would be a mobile unit with a docking station outside the building. So when the power comes out, we can just pull right up and plug it in just because of the real estate here at town hall. And then the police station, we're actually, the existing one is in the basement, so we're actually relocating that outside on a pad mount. So and all the work is being done by DPW staff.
So is this a police and town hall generator?
No, two separate.
Two separate,
but it's all part of a single grant. And the what you see before you on your capital plan there, that's going to be the town's portion of the grant for both generators, that $34,000.
So, but that is satisfying the issue of the town hall generator?
Yes.
So could, I guess.
The town hall comes down about three or four items later, Jim, down the list.
And it's split, okay.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay. That's what I was getting confused at, Mary, thank you. All right, questions? All right, let's move on. One ton dump truck, 550 replaced with another 550. Questions for Bruce on that? Okay. Then the self-contained breathing apparatus, this is for the fire department, $112,000, general fund and grant. This is the town's share of a grant, which is pending approval. So is this 112 from general fund and the rest is via a grant, or?
If the fire department is successful in getting the grant, then we would have to come up with $20,000, which is what our request is. If they do not get the grant, they do not need the $20,000.
So I'm looking at a number on our spreadsheet that says $112,000.
Yep, that's the total cost, but under the general fund tab, it's $20,000 and it's broken out to $92,000 for the grants, under grants.
So if we don't get the grant, Ryan, then this disappears?
Correct.
Oh, okay.
More than likely, it would be carried over till next year when they would reapply for the grant.
Thank you.
So when you say general fund tab, what are you referring to? Sorry for my... thick-headedness.
We're probably looking at different sheets, to be honest. I think I have the computer version and you have the printout version.
Right. Ours is just listing them in line and just showing. So what we see is by the breathing apparatus is project total $112,000, proposed funding source general fund / grant. So
it's $20,000 would be general fund, and then $92,000 is coming from the grant. So if we don't get that $92,000, then they would not expend that $20,000. I'm gonna assume that the fire department would reapply for the grant the following year, and then that money would already be appropriated for our portion of the grant.
So, but if I understand you correctly, this number for the purposes of the general fund budget would be $20,000.
Yep. Okay,
thank you. Then we have the EPW sidewalk fund. And the capital planning committee took a different tack this year with the theory, and I think Ralph brought it up for starters. And I'll let Bruce explain the idea.
So I believe Ralph's idea was to actually bond, I guess, what does he say, $1 million? And then just try to get as much as we can done with that $1 million. And I know Steve ran the numbers, but in order for the town to take on such a large project, I don't think the committee felt it was something that they wanted to pursue just based on the volume of work that was needed to expend that type of money in that period of time. So specifically, when we receive capital funding, typically it's a year to 2 years to expend that monies. So I think it was the capital committee, James.
So I kind of remember it that Ralph's pitch was, look at we're spending $75,000. We're trying to allocate $75,000 a year towards sidewalk improvements. And what he suggested was, why don't we take what we could borrow now that would cost us $75,000 a year and do them all, you know, do them now so that the town and the residents would have the benefit of the expanded sidewalk system, and we would still spend roughly the same amount we had been planning to spend anyhow, but this time on debt and interest as opposed to a year-to-year allocation for the sidewalk fund. And so that was the theory. And you know, I think Steve came out that you could get about $1 million to $1.2 million. You could shoehorn into that roughly $75,000 a year a debt service. I mean, the one thing that, you know, is a difference is that the town has a chance to decide from year to year, you know, whether they do the 75, whether they do 50, whether they do zero. Once we bond, that's going to be 75 or whatever the debt payment will be. And we won't have any time on it, but which makes me wonder, the $1.2 million that's showing up on the project total, that is the project total, but it isn't the impact on the town's general fund budget, right? So that one, Steve, is another one that theoretically we should have something around 75,000-80,000.
I'm sorry, Steve, were you saying something?
Yeah, that's how we got to the $1.2 million, is we figured on roughly 75 a year, which is what was originally being asked to budget for each year. But Bruce is absolutely right, too. If we get the $1.2 million, you have to spend that within a couple of years. And Jim, you're right in that you have no choice after that. You have to pay it back.
Yeah. Well, and Jim, what I was going to add was that this fiscal 22 submissions document, these two pages, were extracted from our comprehensive plan. So there was no breakdown, as you rightly point out, that we did last year with the debt and the debt service amounts as the impact to the operational budget. So I'm thinking as we go along, we should really redo this and reflect those additional numbers or the change numbers. But equally as important, we're about to receive almost $5,000 in the community over this fiscal 22 and 23 that I think is going to impact our decision making about what we're going to bond for, because why pay interest for 30 years if we have cash that can be dedicated to certain projects like infrastructure? So it may be that when this money hits the town coffers, we decide we don't want to bond for Meadowbrook School or whatever school that was. It's not Meadowbrook, it's Mountain View. For example, or for the sidewalk program. Maybe we can spend $1 million on sidewalks without going out to bond. So I'm kind of got a foot in each camp right now, mm-hmm. but I can see where some of the confusion's coming, because you're looking for debt service figures as they impact the operational budget, and this document shows the project totals, as I said, because it was composed as part of the comprehensive package that just had the fiscal 22 submissions before those breakdowns.
Right. I think before our committee could vote on the you know, whether we agree with the recommendations or not, the it'll be helpful for us to have those debt service numbers that we can project. Yes, Steve.
I just sent a request to Hilltop, so hopefully we'll have it within a few days.
Sounds good. Rich, you had a question?
Yeah, just to Mr. Feeney, I'm a little bit confused. This amount, it has to be expended over how many years?
Well, typically, like I said, when we get a project of that magnitude, typically any capital project within, depending on the size, within 2 to 3 years is to complete the project its entirety, yes.
Yeah, but is this realistic for your DPW to accomplish that?
Oh, no. This would all go out to bid. It'd have to be bid out.
Yeah. Okay, sorry. Thank you.
Definitely.
You see Bruce out there with a shovel.
That's what I was saying, Ryan.
All right. Hang on.
The other two.
Hang on, Chris.
How long would we be bonding for?
I believe it's 20 years.
20 years. Seems like a long time for
sure. For some reason, I thought it was 10 that we were using. It's 20 years?
I believe usually it's around 20, but I'd have to verify it. I don't know.
The one we just did in November, well, 30? Am I mistaken?
It depends on the type of project that you have is how they classify it.
Yeah.
And so building a school might be 30, but this might be, you know.
Right, but for some reason I thought that part of the discussion was, you know, because for that period of time, we're basically not putting any new sidewalks on anywhere. In any event, you're going
to verify and I'll send out a response of both and everything else.
All right, any other questions regarding the sidewalks? Okay, then we have the Allen Street landfill closure. Then we have the town hall, this town hall portion of the trailer mount generator.
Bruce, just for the generator stuff, do we have to actually come up with money from our side?
So, for both generators, the town share, based on my calculations and the grant information, is roughly $36,063.52. So I'd like to, like you said, that $38,000 even number for both generators would be enough to cover everything for both generators.
Okay, because we have $0 from the town's from general fund.
Right, right.
Now I'm totally confused, guys. I have to say.
Let's start over. So, when we talked about the police generator, it was the $34,000, and now an $85,000 for the grant. What's the $38,000 that you're talking about?
Well, for both, like I said previously, and this kind of gets confusing. I did bring it up during our meeting when we were discussing capital. So, for both generators, if we do receive the grant, the town share is going to be $36,063.52.
So why don't we have a number for the general fund portion?
We don't have one on there. I think it was an oversight. Okay. When Bruce was just explaining the last one, that's kind of what made me think about it. So like the total project's like $120,000 for the two generators.
Yeah.
So we would need to include $38,000. We would need to add $38,000 into the capital plan or some other funding source for the town's portion of those two projects.
Whose spreadsheet is this?
I have the spreadsheet, the master spreadsheet. I can share my screen that has all the columns broken out. It was way too big to print on a piece of paper.
Perhaps, Ryan, would you be the logical person to kind of make corrections to this sheet?
Probably, I think so.
I can make them as well.
It's just right. Like you said. Because I'd like to get it corrected, one that else, you know, we can also include the debt services in for next week, if at all possible.
Yeah, because I still got to remove the $200,000 out of there, which we don't obviously
need. Right, right.
And I think originally, Ryan, when we put in these numbers, we didn't actually have any kind of decision about the grant. So we ended up putting in the original numbers, and then we modified it based on, because I believe Mary, and forgive me if I don't know the exact date, but I think in February we received that our grant application was going to the final steps in the approval process.
Right, and that's my point about saying that this is an extrapolation from our comprehensive plan, which was created before we knew whether the grants had been approved and how much they'd been approved, and we were trying to create a comprehensive listing of projects and their potential costs, which doesn't dovetail exactly into your purposes in this committee. And it's going to be further complicated because this is what went to the council, and next Tuesday they're not getting any changes to this because we're not going to have any of the information that I don't think we'll have any of the information, and I have to give the town clerk my materials for next Tuesday this afternoon. So just doesn't make sense. But in any case, I acknowledge the fact that this list is not helpful for you.
Well, I mean, it gets the whole list. It's just the way it's presented for us, for our particular purposes, isn't set up that way. So we've got quite a few items still to go. So it's almost 10 past two. So I just want to just keep everybody in mind of the time frames. The next item is the maple shade exterior doors, replacing the vestibule doors and the custodial entrance doors. And Kathy did have a question, or Tom had a question on this. He thought it might have been funded in previous years or was already done. And I'm not sure if I went back and looked, and we did a $256,000 office renovation project, but it's a different school. It wasn't the same school as these doors are now being addressed at.
Right, so part of the MSBA accelerated repair program, and Rich, forgive me if I get the dates wrong again, I believe it was 2 to 3 years ago. So Meadowbrook School received all the new doors and windows and security upgrades to that facility, not Maple Shade. Maple Shade School has had extensive door replacements over the past 3 to 4 years. And this is just another area of concern, and mainly in the front vestibule of the school, in order for the principal and the secretary at that location to have people access into a foyer, into a locked area, and then allow them into the facility.
So Bruce, it said this had been submitted to capital plan for the last 3 years. This specific project for these specific doors?
Have not.
I actually saw it. I tried to go back and try to find it.
It's, yes. And this would happen as well, too. We came up with a whole plan 1 year. And then after that was done, we wanted to do more doors. So each year, it kind of just kept snowballing into more and more doors with the principal and security concerns and things like that. What we should have done is done the whole building all at once instead of just piecemealing, but it's still the same outcome. It's for security reasons for the front of the building at Maple Shade School.
Any questions for Bruce on this item? Okay, let's keep moving on. Then there's the bunker gear for the firefighters, and seemed like it was pretty necessary. Any questions on that? Then we have the townwide crack sealing of the parking lots for $82,500. This has been on our capital plan at least 1 or 2 years. And it's always a question of, how long is too long, and when is enough? So I think the feeling of the capital planning was this was probably a year that we ought to do it. Any questions on that one? And obviously, if you have questions that come up after the meeting, we'll do some follow-ups because we'll actually see Bruce and Ryan next week. Yes, Chris, it looked like you were going
to... Is this going out to bid or is it being done?
Yes, this will be a bid project. Typically, we do, like you said, crack sealing. So all our streets and everything else in town, we typically do that every other year as part of our Chapter 90 allocation.
Okay.
So we'll probably dovetail that on our townwide crack sealing for the streets to hopefully get a better price as well.
Okay.
Then the van number 47 replacing the Ford Transit cargo van. Kathy did have a question on that. She was interested to get a little better understanding as for the rationale to replace it.
Okay, let me get my sheet here. Well, maybe I have it in my other sheet.
Just for clarification, there was no description with this item.
Oh, this is to, yeah, this is to replace, actually, the existing truck 47 is actually down. It's been down for quite some time. Let me just find it in my 180 page document here. Here you go. So this is our truck 47. The truck is actually parked out back at the garage. It has extensive rust damage and will not pass inspection. Vehicle has been out of service for a year and a half due to engine failure. The book value of the vehicle is lower than the cost to repair the vehicle itself right now, so therefore we parked it. The current mileage is 175,615 miles, and it's a 2001. So we're replacing it, obviously, because we can no longer drive this one.
So I'm just kind of inferring from Kathy's question, since it's been out of service, the question might be, if you haven't been using it, do you really need it?
Well, we've taken a vehicle from another division within the DPW, so therefore our transportation needs are lacking right now. So therefore, this is part of the building maintenance division. We actually took one of the parks department's division's vehicle, and that's what one of our guys is using right now. So yeah, just back to building maintenance, and we'll shift that other truck back to the parks department.
It dawns on me, and it really didn't sink in, because the financial oversight committee members who were not on the capital planning, Mary's capital planning committee, you did not receive the individual justifications that went along with this. For the ones that people had questions, I can certainly share my documents because I was on the capital planning committee. And maybe we make a note for the future. I think even though it's a lot more paperwork, you would be able to see the rationales. And I think that would be helpful for your, even the efficiency of the questions that we ask going over it. So make a note. Okay, moving on. We have the desktops, iPads. This is a part of a continuing program.
Yep, a continuing program. This also was reduced last year, and I broke the difference out over 2 years. But as a huge benefit, through grant money, we funded replacement of the teacher MacBook computers to the tune of $220,000, which positively impacts our capital replacement plan for the next 5 years. So now for the next 5 years, we don't need to, probably four, I'll probably start replacing some a little early, but we won't need to replace any teacher computers. So that was a huge help.
Yeah. And then moving to the next page, we have Yes, we have the carpet replacement at Birchland Park.
That building is 20 years old. I'm just, wow, just amazed. I remember when we built it.
Yeah.
Seems I remember when we were talking about knocking the old one down.
Ah,
and saying, are you sure we can't just fix it? next is the Heritage Park redevelopment construction and documents. Now, this is a 471.5, which would not be a general fund expense at this point, or not proposed to be, but rather be a funded by the Community Preservation Committee. I will say that Kathy had questions about it. She didn't recall an actual agreed upon architectural rendering that was made available to the council, and she'd like some questions regarding the dollars being requested and what they actually, you know, provide. So this one, I don't recall us actually approving this through the Capital Planning Committee per se. Maybe I was just,
We recommended it and then it has to go to Community Preservation.
With the idea that it wouldn't be a general fund expense.
Correct, yep.
All right. And then the next item is resurface the East Long Meadow High School track. And I think last year or after this process, Mary had started discussion with CPC.
Yeah, they finally approved everything and the council approved it the other night. So that project is under contract or soon will be, according to Bruce.
Yeah, so that's 106,722 out of community preservation and 28,000 from the ELPS rental accounts.
Yeah. I was going to ask that question because we had that account always set aside for the trash.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw your hand, Rich. I knew you were going to ask.
And then we have the VAC jet truck, which is kind of like a super sucker out of the goes around to each of the drains, I assume, and.
Yes, it's actually going to be 50% funded out of sewer and 50% out of stormwater. So this is going to replace. So we currently have two pieces of equipment now. One's a tow behind trailer. It's a vacuum trailer that we currently use. And our existing jet truck is a 1978 or I want to get it right here. The jet truck. So it's our existing jet truck is a 1987. It's frequently breaking down on us. We can't get parts for the vehicle anymore. So we're, like you said, we're asking for funding to be split between our sewer and stormwater division. It's a big purchase, but it's going to obviously help us out in the future and help with obviously our ability to operate more efficiently with one piece of equipment on a single vehicle.
And I understand, Bruce, that this is not going to result in increases in fees in stormwater or sewer.
Nope.
And just a question, that in the key that B means that's going to be bonded?
Yes.
Okay.
It'll be bonded.
That's my recommendation.
Yeah, and paid through those enterprise funds.
It's also, I mean, this piece of equipment's older than most of our police officers, but there's also a sewer closed capital project that we're going to take $32,475 from. So the sewer bonding would actually only be $228,556.
And then we have the Vineland Pump Station, a major service that will come out of the sewer enterprise fund. Mm-hmm. And then replacing the water main, Cooley Avenue and Avery Street, which will come out of the water enterprise fund. And then finally, we have the final, third of three payments, lease payments for the fire rescue truck And that'll come out of the ambulance enterprise fund.
So this item will be closed out this year.
Yep.
So what I would propose is that perhaps I can work a little bit with Ryan and either Steve or Mary. What I'd like to do is clean up this spreadsheet and so that we have it for next week to look at, you know, maybe more targeted to what we're trying to see, and also with the numbers, you know, the kind of included, whether it's a general fund impact or not. So that would be my proposal for homework, to get us something that's like, now that we've seen it, hopefully we'll be able to walk through it, but actually see the numbers the way they'll impact the general fund budget.
Jim, can I ask Mike a question?
Yes, Chris actually raised her hand.
Then I'll go
to you. Yes, Chris.
I just have a question. On the key, it says Casino Mitigation Fund, and there's an amount of $41,380. And I didn't understand as we went through that we were taking any money from that fund. So I was wondering.
Yeah, we're not, Chris. That is a misnomer. When this sheet was compiled, there was some question about where that, this is the leftover money for the police cruiser, but it was not taken from a mitigation fund. It happens to be the correct balance. And initially the council voted to buy a pickup truck, and they designated the fund as the community mitigation, casino mitigation. And then that vote was subsequently rescinded, right, and that money has flowed into the capital project. So it's really leftover money in a closed capital project.
Okay, thanks, Mary.
Mary, you said you wanted to ask somebody something. Go right ahead.
Well, I you know, we just sent a package 2 inches thick to the clerk's office to be distributed to the council, which is my final budget, which includes this. It does not include the proper operational impact for the capital projects that are going to be bonded. So if Mike wants to give me a dispensation and maybe we can submit something on Monday that's going to be correct, because I'm going to give this to the council on Tuesday night, and the operational impact from these capital projects is not accurate. And that's, I want to make this process better, and I'm extremely frustrated by the inability to do that. So any suggestions, Mike, or I know you can't probably speak for the whole council, but.
I think I pretty much can in one aspect, that we're controlling the agenda and meetings that take place. But before I comment, Steve, did you have something you wanted to add to this?
Hey, I just received an email from them, through the chair, sorry, an email from Hilltop, so we can get those figures. They're working on them now. So I'm hoping we'll have them be today or tomorrow, frankly, but I don't know if that'll impact the decision on how, if we can put this through on Tuesday's meeting.
Okay, so through the chair again, Mary, to answer your question, I'd rather delay it or have an extra council meeting or an extra session and have the information that's submitted, if it's correct, rather than throwing something forward just to try to make it for Tuesday night's meeting that's misrepresented, if you will. So whatever latitude you need, we're going to have either an extra meeting or postpone it until we have the correct information. But I'm sure we'll meet the timeline. We'll make it work.
Well, if we get the information from Hilltop that represents the debt service, there's only 4 or 5 items, including those that are coming out of the enterprise funds, that we would need to recalculate, but they all have to be uploaded into the sources and uses, which then changes 5 or 6 pages in that document because of the flow through of the numbers and the formula. So, I mean, I hate to make a mountain out of a molehill, but it's going to take some time. And the charter says May 1st, and Tuesday's meeting is April 27th. So I'd like to comply with that if we can, but I don't know.
Well, I mean, the bonding numbers that we used, we got from Hilltop already as estimates. So I think the only changes that would need to be made would be, as far as capital goes, the 200,000 coming off and then adding.
I already made that change though, Ryan. I did that myself and Steve. We did all that today so that we could submit this to the,
And Ryan, the 950.
We don't have a bonding number. We don't have a debt service number on the trailer classrooms, do we?
No. That was a flat, it's going to cost this much. The $1.2 million was based on 75 and some, you know, 75,000 a year that we were planning on, that Bruce has asked for each year for a sidewalk. What can we borrow to get to that number?
Right.
And so that we have the one for the sidewalks. That's how we were able to get that number. As I said, Hilltop just emailed me. They're sending me the breakdown for the 950. And we should be able to get something hopefully in the next day or so to have it done, but depending on time deadlines, what we can do. But Mary's right, the 250 or 200 came off already.
Yeah, and I mean, it's a good problem to have because the reduction in those amounts, I mean, just taking the 200,000 out for that core network failure took 10 cents off the tax rate, off the proposed tax rate. So if we knock off another million or so. Yeah. From these other projects,
to substitute debt service for the principal, make another pretty big difference. So it would be worth having.
Oh, definitely
those numbers.
You know, I want to. We just pause. I understand Mary's frustration. I'm thinking politically, and for Mary, there's two different parallel processes going on. Our process and the town council, and for Tuesday. If Mary doesn't show up with some documents, I think that could be politically unstable. I'm going to use that. I don't know if that's the right word. I mean, I think do we give them this document working on now, stating that the Financial Oversight Committee is still working on a number of different projects? It gives Mary the flexibility to propose it, but we're still working on it. I don't know if that's an answer, Mary.
Well, it's an option, Rich, and I appreciate that, but I do think it's my responsibility to present an operating budget that's accurate, that reflects only the debt service and not the cost of the project. Right. So I will take the hit for that, and I'm rather suffering some consternation here because that's not the way this was done. But it's all right. We'll fix it, and maybe we'll get it fixed by Tuesday, Mike. So.
Through the chair.
All right.
We will, Mary. We'll have a chance to work at it. We'll see what we have, and I'm sure there's a logical solution. So we'll have time to.
Through the chair. Right. I think it's emphasized that it's the process that's causing this, not any particular position or person. It's the process.
Yeah, but you know, process gets exalted sometimes.
Right. So let's circle back to. The capital plan and the sheet that we did review. Does anybody have any specific questions, knowing that we will be reviewing it one more time next week? Bruce?
I want to recap on the generator portion. So the numbers that we have in there are actually accurate. We just didn't take into consideration the grant through those. So if we were to fund those each individually, that's how much it would cost the town. So the town hall is at 85,846 that we proposed, and then the police station was 34,093. The number I gave you for the grant is what it would cost the town to proceed with both of those projects if we did receive the grant. And I do see on the capital spreadsheet, there's a $0 figure for each.
Well, okay. I'm not sure that helped me much.
I just wanted to clarify.
What I'm looking at on the spreadsheet is the 34,000, which it says grant, and 85,000, which it says grant. So I'm still not sure I follow it. So let's not try to hash it out at this meeting. We'll just follow up and make sure we've got the correct numbers. And we'll get that set up for next week. Thank you, though. I appreciate it. Any other questions on the capital plan until we meet again? if you have any in the interim, please send them to me and I will certainly forward them along. In that instance, I would like to thank Ryan and Bruce for joining us and allowing us to pepper you with questions. And I'm glad we kind of walked through. I'm a little chagrined at myself for not having looked more closely at the spreadsheet beforehand. But in any event, we'll clarify that and work through it. Chris, did you have a comment? Okay, all right. So thank you, Bruce. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you. Our next agenda item is the new position proposed in the town manager's budget. And I thank Tom and Kathy in absentia for their input. All right. Thank you for your pretty extensive explanation and pitch for the position, Mary. And everybody, I believe, should have had a chance to read it through. I'll just have one general comment before we talk about any discussion is, I see 18 department heads and my head explodes. I don't know how that works.
Some days better than others.
I used to complain when it was over six. So in any event, Mary, do you have any opening comments or do you just want to have us ask questions or?
I'll be brief, Jim. I know you're trying to keep to a time frame because I appreciate the opportunity to at least explain or answer your questions that you may have. I guess I wanted to be clear that I wanted the opportunity to use some of our, and I hate to call them excess funds because they're taxpayer monies, but by virtue of savings we made in the new hires in four or five department heads this past year, we've saved $58,000 in salaries that were in the budget last year. And in light of everything that's happened in this office over the last year, I thought it was necessary for a number of reasons that I tried to articulate here to get some assistance in the form of a deputy position. And I couched it as a pilot and part-time because I'm not certain as I sit here that some of these problems aren't the result of COVID, that some of them aren't the result of a fairly substantial number of turnovers we've had in department heads. There's been turnover in this office. And there's just a lot going on between COVID and all the funding and the accountability for all that funding and the various sources and having no HR director. I mean, it's been nightmarish, frankly. And I feel, honestly, I feel a bit frustrated because I feel as though there's a lot of things that I could accomplish from this position that I cannot even start to think about because I don't have time to do that. And that's very important to me. And it's also important to me to be a better leader and a better manager for all of those 18 department heads. I feel a strong obligation and responsibility to help each one of those people be the best manager they can be. And I feel hamstrung in my efforts to do that as well. So that's in a nutshell why I want the position. And that's it. So now I'm happy to take your question if you have any specific ones. Oh, also, let me just add, the council continuously has posited succession plans for departments as one of my goals. And I've repeatedly told the council that requires budget adjustments because you can't have a deputy police chief, fire chief, town manager without spending some money to do that. So this year of evidence, assuming I get this position and find the right candidate, would at least give me some facts on which to argue pro or con in fiscal years to come.
Okay, thank you, Mary. I'll just make one comment on our timeline. I at the outset, when we had our kind of organizational meeting, we kind of targeted an hour and a half for our typical meeting. So I'm going to try as much as I can to work within that time frame. But if we have issues that come up and we're in the middle of them, or they need to be discussed and people feel like continuing, it's not a hard and fast. I don't see it as a hard and fast hour and a half. So, you know, I'll go by, you know, the committee's, the members' feelings about, you know, whether we extend or not. But I just felt bad. I didn't mean to shortchange your discussion, Mary.
No, not at all, Jim.
Okay. Questions for Mary? Yes, Chris.
Well, after reading this, there's no doubt in my mind that Mary needs some assistance in that office because, and I agree with her that some of these things may be one-time occurrences. However, the burden of the job, the, you know, 18 department heads, 17 boards, you know, five union contracts to deal with. There's no doubt in my mind that she needs some kind of support in that office to be able to function and do some of the things that a town manager would want to do. However, I do have a question for Mary because she said something about on page 2, she thought that perhaps the individual could also serve as the director of administration and financing and encompassing HR as well. And I wanted to know where she saw that model, where, if she's seen it somewhere, and how it has worked.
I haven't seen that specific model, but trying to superimpose like the Springfield model on a town like East Long Meadow, I'm thinking that if we had a chief finance officer or a director of administration and finance that would sort of be the intermediary, quote unquote, deputy to the town manager and be responsible as the mid-level position for all of those functions that are encompassed in administration and finance. I mean, I purposely hired an HR director. She's not called a director, it's an HR manager, because my long-term goal is to consolidate some of the responsibility in, and I'd like to develop this position from in-house. Right now, I don't know of anybody who's even interested in-house or who has the qualifications that I think would be necessary to do it. It's kind of still a work in progress, Chris. There is no specific town that I can point to and say, oh yeah, they do it this way in Webster or West Springfield or whatever. But I think these functions, HR and payroll, are constantly back and forth. The payroll currently in East Long Meadow is administered out of the finance office. And yet the HR generalist wears out her shoes walking back and forth, because every time there's a step increase or a promotion or a resignation or a new hire, all of the fiscal data is managed down the hall. And I think payroll should be a function that's in HR. I think in most places it is. And I think it would streamline our function. But our whole HR function is kind of disorganized, let's put it that way. The position, the directorship was vacant for a year and a half. It resulted in enormously negative consequences that we're still trying to dig out from under. We had an interim director for the last year. Now we have a permanent director. The town council authorized a large expense last year for automation of our payroll. That was just didn't work. Mm-hmm. So we want to proceed in a different avenue. Along the same theme, but a different resource. And I feel like I want to put it together under one person so that we're all not running around after each other all the time. And that's what it feels like we're doing here many days. I don't, that probably didn't answer your question very well, but.
Yeah, thank you, Mary. Chris, did you have any other questions? Rich has a.
Let Rich go.
All right, go ahead, Rich.
You sure, Mary? You don't, Chris, you don't do a follow up?
Well, I was.
Yeah, please do, because I didn't answer you, I don't think.
I wanted to make the comment that this almost sounds like a position that you envision moving out of your office and into a higher position. If that is the case, I would suggest, my inclination would be to suggest that you need the support in your office, and that would be an entirely different position that would have to be brought on board, especially if you envisioned bringing HR into finance and administration, because yes, that would require a person of a certain caliber with credentials. That's my only comment.
No, I see where you're going with that, and that makes perfect sense. I think my mind was, if many of these activities and tasks that take so much of my time, I mean, the last year, when we had no finance director and no HR director, I'm the town manager, and I was doing those three jobs, basically. And that, I think if that situation were fixed, then, you know, I'm not going to say I would never want to have a deputy town manager in addition, but I think that this position would substitute for that.
All right. Thank you, Mary. Rich.
Mary, just define for me, you say it's a pilot part-time position. What do you see that as, starting in January, or a four-year position, 20 hours? How would you define it?
I'm thinking it would start the first of the fiscal year, so July, if we could find the right person, and be like a 20-hour position. I mean, I didn't want to be greedy, Rich, to tell you the truth. Mm-hmm. I was trying to be mindful of the budget, and I didn't, here I am telling the department heads to do level services and, you know, no extras, and I'm the one that's throwing a position out there. So a little guilt was in the mix, to be honest. But so, I mean, yeah, a full-time position would be better. And some, but the caveat there is, I don't want to hire somebody from the outside, create an expectation that this is a career position for some new person, when I think we have talent internally that could be developed. And that was also in my contemplation when I thought, well, maybe 20 hours on a pilot. And in the meanwhile, we can perhaps mentor or develop in-house people who would be interested. So, you know, I don't know, maybe it's not a good idea to only have a 20-hour position, because, but.
Rich, other questions?
No,
and then Mike, I'll get to Rich. All right, Mike, go ahead.
Okay. I just wanted to add that I heard Mary say she feels a little bit guilty about asking for this, but I've been actually pushing this forward for quite some time, okay? Because I see what she has on her plate and how much time she spends working on items, and I feel that she could prioritize on pieces that need attention sooner than later, that are time sensitive, and we're getting bogged down with other issues that could be handled by somebody of her choice that could step up and take that workload off her back. I think it's imperative, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about this because our time is sensitive here, but I've been in and out of that office for approximately 5 years, and I've seen both managers, our previous manager, struggle with the same situation. So it's time to address it, and I'm hopeful that we can find the right person and the funds to make it happen.
Thank you, Mike. I did have a couple of questions. For everyone's information, in the town manager budget, there is $35,000 in for this new part-time position. And did you say, Mary, your intention would be to not hire that position until January 1st?
No, July 1st, but it would be 20 hours a week, Jim.
All right, thank you. So my three questions, I guess, are, number one, I just want to, so what you're looking for is a special projects, grants administrator kind of person at the outset. I mean, this isn't someone who would be a deputy town manager. Now, if I read your write-up, it's as if this position made sense and would grow, it could grow into a deputy town manager? Was that the way you were thinking of it?
Well, yes and no. I chose the verbiage deputy town manager because if there is a person in this position, I want that individual to have authority and be respected by the other department heads. So I think if I'm calling the person a grants administrator or a projects coordinator, that might be that might not be the best situation. So that was really the reason for that verbiage.
So, but they wouldn't at the outset have direct reports or whatever.
No, they'd essentially be my assistant, but I have an admin assistant, so I didn't want to have two assistants and say, well, this is the substantive assistant and this is the admin assistant. Okay. So that was why I got away from the assistant title.
So my another question is, and again, it may not be feasible at all, but I mean, another approach to minimizing or reducing the number of direct reports would be to, if you had some department heads that you could have act as direct supervisors of other department heads, so that perhaps you would have 3, 4, 5, or 6 department heads who might have other departments reporting to them. It's just, it would be a mechanical way of reducing direct reports. Is that even a possibility to consider?
Well, it kind of exists now with Steve's job because Dawn Fonte and Diane Bishop in the assessor's office are considered part of the municipal finance department. And so they probably have some conversations with Steve, but they also come to me directly and they, you know, so, I mean, we have that in the charter. And I guess I was thinking that we could amplify on that model by the director of administration and finance that Chris had spoken about. I don't know though, because you know, everybody's independent but for Diane and Dawn, and they essentially are pretty independent too. No offense to Steve, but he gives them a lot of leeway. So I don't know how that would fly among the department heads. I don't know how that would be received if all of a sudden, you know, 2 or 3 departments were gonna be accountable to somebody else besides me. I don't know.
Yeah, Chris.
Well, I know I checked the charter, and as far as picking someone in case Mary goes on vacation or she has to be out family reasons, whatever, that the charter stipulates a department head to name a department head, which I think she has in the past. She's had Ryan, and from what I understand, he's done a very good job. But what if it had to be 6 weeks or 8 weeks?
Steve has been appointed in that role, Steve Lonergan.
Okay.
That has taken place. I've designated Steve in the event that I'm absent for some extended period.
Okay, that clears something up, Mary. Thank you.
So my last question, Mary, is, this year seems like a very opportune year with the change in department head salaries between the former ones and the current ones, as well as the shift of a lot of salary from fire general fund to ambulance fund. And so my question is, this gives you the room, I agree, to add like the police position, the fire position, you've got Steve's position, you've got your position. My question is, I guess, if we were to do that and you'd be at your, let's quote say, a reasonable increase, what happens next year when, you know, instead of 6 months, the fire and police will have a full year of salaries, and if these positions were proved out to be useful, we'd have those. It seems like that might build up a kind of a speed bump for FY23 in terms of salaries and expenses. I'm just trying to think it through a little bit.
Yeah, well, that's why I was thinking of it as a pilot for 20 hours, because I wanted to take fiscal 22 to see who among the existing suspects would be amenable to developing that career path, if any of them.
Yeah.
And if there were such an individual that was interested and qualified, then there perhaps wouldn't have to be a huge bump in salary. Maybe it'd be a little bit of a bump. Yeah. But again, this is another reason why, and Mike will laugh at this, it's why I would like to have ongoing quarterly financial subcommittee talks, because I'm sitting here trying to figure these things out, trying to have it make sense and be feasible economically. But sometimes you feel like you're in a vacuum, you know, and it's only opportunities like this where we get to even talk about it. So I know Mike's well aware of my request in that regard, and he's been extremely helpful. So, I mean, you're raising a very good point. It could create a big problem in 23. I would hope that we'd have an internal candidate who would be willing to do that, because some of the other departments in which we're saving money now are going to be deserving of raises. And so there's that to consider as well.
Okay, fair enough. And I appreciate the idea that you're doing some of these on a kind of pilot basis. But okay. And I will just make a comment personally. I would be happy to, you know, if I were to be on the Financial Oversight Committee, I would be happy to, you know, participate in the quarterly meetings if that were beneficial.
Thank you.
Questions, other questions for Mary on that position? Hearing none, we'll move forward. Those are the major items we wanted to get through tonight, I mean this afternoon. You've got some follow-up information. I do want to circle back on the COVID-related funding, not this afternoon, but there looks like there's a lot of potential money. I'm just not sure how it works and how we avail ourselves of it, and that's a question for the town side. Also a question for the school side, which I sent them the same documentation, and hopefully they can fill in on their end what they're going to do.
Well, I was on a webinar yesterday, Jim, and the detail, the first distributions are supposed to be made May 10th, and the detail from Treasury as far as uses and restrictions on uses will follow at some point after that. So we think it's very broad, the availability for infrastructure development and recoupment of lost revenue, and they're using fiscal 19 as a benchmark. So we think we can reasonably anticipate some assistance. And the legislature has also started its debate. I think April 26th is the first session. I got an email today about that. So all the signals are that there'll be more money available, but nothing is written yet or voted on. I mean, that ARPA legislation is $1.9 trillion, and East Long Meadow is going to get almost $5 million, 4.7, I believe, is the number we had.
Yeah.
So, and that's just on the town side. The school ESSER funding is separate.
So is there a meeting date you might have information that you'd be able to share with us, Mary?
Well, I don't have a date in mind, but I will, as soon as I know more specifics, I'll certainly let you know.
Okay. All right. Because I'd like to make sure we understand it. And I, you know, we'll target to kind of go over the school with the schools when they come to meet us. But at whatever point you feel you've got the information you could share with us, we can add it to an agenda.
Sure.
Then the only other thing I had thrown on our agenda, and we aren't going to get to it today, but it's not an absolute urgency, is discussing the format we want to use for our presentation of our recommendations to the town council. When I kind of look at our time frame, we have the DPW and IT on the 29th, we have the schools on the 6th, the town budget hearing is the 11th, and Wednesday, May 12th, we need to make our decisions and finalize them at least by Thursday, the 13th. However, really it's the, we need to get, be able to put our recommendations into a, some format to provide to the town council because fairly quickly, because it seems to me that the logical town council meeting to give our recommendations would be the 18th, May 18th, which would leave one week beyond if for some reason there needed to be a follow-up to that. So that leaves us only like a couple of days to put together, once we've decided our votes, to put together how that, how we explain it to the town council. So I think if we can kind of hash that out as we're going along, then once we make our votes, we'll just plug it into the format and, you know, we'll have it instead of starting from scratch. But we can, I'll put it on our agenda for next week. And just to recap, so it's DPW and IT and 1:30 next week.
I won't be here, just to remind everybody, I will not be here for that.
All right, yep, gotcha, thank you. Anything else before we wrap up? All right, hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to, first of all, I'll say thank you all for participating, and I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All right, Rich and Chris second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye. Rich?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
Jim? Yes. All right, we are adjourned. Thank you all.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks for your time.